在收看的是第一财经中国经济论坛。
好，欢迎。
Welcome. Today we have a very strong panelist team, and we will give you a brief introduction to them later. And after my introduction to each and every panelist, because we're a live broadcast, so please join me to give them a round of applause. And we have with us Huang Yiping, Professor, National School of Development, Peking University, People's Republic of China. And also, we have together with us a friendly face with a foreign face, but he has a Chinese name, Ji Kui Sheng, Gregory. Gibb, co-chairman and CEO, Shanghai Lujiazui International Financial Asset Exchange, Lufax. And also we have Zhou Yanli, vice chairman, CIRC. We have a lot of problems, but not in the insurance market. Mr. Zhou, welcome. And also we have the only female Mio Takaoka, Managing Director, Monex Ventures, Executive Director, New Business Planning Office, Monex Group.
And last but not least, 就是我们这个。
And also we have Mr. Jia Kang, just arrived from Beijing. President, China Academy of New Supply Side Economics. Because in the past year, the reform on the supply side is a buzzword, and also he is a delegate of the CPPCC. So he worked in the Ministry of Finance and a research fellow. So thank you, Mr. Jia Kang. Thank you all. Just now, in a video clip, China has a lot of like the corporate debt, non-performing loans, capital outflows, and also the pressure of the depreciation of renminbi, fintech, and new risks, all kinds of problems. But all these kind of problems are not in the insurance market. So are you satisfied with this, or are you also worried about the risks in the other markets? Well, we have to make sure that we can give a very good guardian of the other market. This is the very nature of the insurance, because we want to prevent risks and cushion the blows. Because when we provide the insurance, we can actually anticipate, identify, and cushion the risks, quantify them, and showcase to the general public. So meanwhile, we can also be practical, specific, to be precise, targeted, and also to provide a very good solid foundation for the anticipation and forecast of the macro economy. Apart from these risks, we also have a lot of risks in the economic operation activities, and I really hope that we can capitalize on the tool of the insurance market, and also we can provide the insurance and also decrease the risks. And also in terms of the operation, maybe there is some risks to the human beings, to your body, to your property, and also some risks caused by natural disasters. So we can plan and also prevent all these. And also against the backdrop of some uncertainties, we can also make a full use of this tool of insurance so that we can promote the smooth development in the economic and social development. Very effective. We have this Chinese saying that sometimes people are faced with a double whammy situation. So thank you, Mr. Zhou. You just mentioned that we have to provide support to real economy, such as in Shenzhen, we have the risks prevention insurance for the major natural disasters. But in 2008 and 2009, we have the AIG, which is an insurance company at the very center of the financial crisis. And AIG provided all sorts of derivatives. And China does not have this. Is that a good thing? Is that a showcase that China does not have this CDS closely linked to all the markets? And also, what's your take on the financial risks? Well, you just mentioned this, which is a good point. AIG used to be an insurance group, and this group provided a lot of financial derivatives. And I think there were two issues that AIG didn't give an anticipation. They only focused on the profitability of their group. First of all, I don't think they focused a lot on the safeguarding nature of insurance, because actually to be an insurance company, you have to provide the support and also cushion a blow. But actually, CDS is actually an insurance product, isn't that? But I don't think the level of the insurance is very high, because actually you can separate or to mitigate risks and distribute all these risks so that you can actually lock down the level of the risks facing the companies. So I don't think they had a very targeted and precise lockdown of all these risks. And also, maybe reinsurance was another effective tool that AIG didn't use. And also, I think in order to have a very good identification of the risks, some of them are virtual. And these had some leverage effect, but AIG didn't give a very good identification of the relations among different risks in terms of the nature of all these. For instance, the natural disaster risks, you can actually provide some of the support. However, Mr. Zhou, I would like to cut you down. A lot of the risks are intertwined. You can't really identify and separate them. And they all have this ripple effect. Yes, you are right. For an insurance company, actually, during this process, you have to do the analysis. Is that the financial risks in terms of the asset management and also the capital use? You can mitigate some of the risks, and also through some analysis, you can also provide the help. If you mingle these two together, then I think sometimes you have a difficulty to identify all these risks, which are quite catastrophic. Take the example of AIG. I think here is the spot that they didn't identify very well. You have to categorize all these risks. For the natural disaster, you have to scale up the insurance level, and also you have to distribute all these risks through the contracts, and also you can have the insurance for the major natural disaster, and also you can research into the legal environment and framework so that effectively you can transfer out all these risks. And for the financial risks, we have to control the leverage rate to an appropriate range so that you can control the risks with a very appropriate reserve. Okay, thank you very much. We will get back to you later for the different correlation of the different markets and also the regulation measures. And also back to the video clip. Actually, the most important thing is the corporate debt or the debt of China. A lot of financial institutions have already argued that the debt has already accounted to 250% of the GDP and 170 to 180% are from the corporate debt, which are caused by the overcapacity and also because of the NPLs. According to IMF, according to their model, while China's corporate debt has actually 15% of them, which is having a high possibility to go wrong. So what's your take on the corporate debt? And also, what is the pressure to the banks? And also, for the financial market, what is the risks and also pressure are there? Well, I have to clarify that according to IMF, they provide the 15% of the figure. They only say that debt to risk is 15%, but this is the different concept to NPL. Well, they also think that 14.5% and also 15%, these are two different takers, but I think there is a figure 7%, but this is not the figure of the NPL.
We all have our own estimation. So as what you said concerning China's high leverage or lever, so we don't have to got the information from foreigners. We know very clearly. So generally, their overall debt in terms of the percentage of GDP, so that's true, it's rising for corporate debt. But the overall volume maybe cannot fully represent our problems. If we move further ahead, actually, so we can see a very interesting phenomenon. So before 2008, our private companies and also the state-owned companies, the leverage is moving simultaneously. But after the year 2008, it's diverged between the SOE. So it's continuous growing, but for the private businesses, it's declining. So when we have this analysis of our leverage between the SOEs and also our private companies, the different indicators. So in the past, so we put more on the lever or the leverage. It's of a bigger concern. They have a low profitability and a higher leverage rate and very poor returns, such a divergence. So there might be some problematic. We have some studies. So the divergence between the two in terms of the leverage. So we have a lot of economic policy uncertainty. And also it's asymmetric for the government, so those endorsement of this credit between the SOEs and the private. So if you say whether it's a high risky or low risk, so that's quite a big problem. So as you said, those very problematic businesses, they have a very high overcapacity, very high leverage. Most of them have turned to into zombie companies. So from another perspective, so normally relating to the SOEs, they have a very high leverage. And so maybe another company undertake this responsibility. So the government responsible for this company, as our Premier Li Keqiang said, maybe as well as the government, the SOEs is not so high, the leverage. So the overall volume of leverage is quite high. It's of a great concern. So compared with other countries, we are very high. But now there's a kind of a different sector difference. We have both good leverage and poor leverage. So in terms of the asset distribution, so most of them concentrated in SOEs. For the industries, maybe it's mining industry, heavy industry, and property industries. So we try to mitigate such a problem. In the short run, if the government want to have their resources to stabilize those debt level, the central government have to undertake some of the responsibility, try to reduce and also stable the overall leverage. But there's a kind of a price for that for the foreign investors. So they talk about the high leverage rate in China. They are very concerned. The similar thing happened in Korea. That is the so-called financial crisis. But I don't think it's possible. So our balance sheet of our Chinese central government is quite okay. If we try to mitigate those stocking, and how about our overall operational flow? So for the phenomenon in Korea, so it's not so high likely. So more and more financial resources have been invested into our economic, but most of them is bad leverage. So the supporting function is getting weaker. Maybe in the short run, we will not have a further growth. We have in Japan the last 20 years. And that is an experience we can learn from Japan. But they are quite a rich country in Japan. We are not so rich. So what he said is quite good. On the whole, we do have the space to migrate those leverage from the business, the private companies, to the public sector. But no way to solve the overall volume problem. Otherwise, we will be the overall volume is OK. But actually, we have no solution. So it's only a migrate to certain sectors. So that is not a solution for our economic growth. For in the long run, it's quite a poor arrangement. So for SOEs, so it's a kind of a soft budget limitation. There's no reform to SOE. We cannot have a solution to the overall corporate debt, including our banks. Banks, these are our state-owned banks. So for de-leveraging, and Mr. Jia, you have been working a long time in the financial systems. You have a lot of contacts with the state-owned enterprises. So how do we understand from your perspective about de-leveraging and the role of the SOE reform? So from Yanqing, so from another perspective, to give my comment, 2 years ago, I heard our people, official from a central bank, we do not admit such a concept, that is the state-owned bank. So we do have some state-owned stock holding banks. So in the overall evolution, we have to stick to. So for the reform of this joint stockholding organizations, what for the actions we can take? So with the overall operation of reform, the deleveraging in China, so we can understand it's in a very traditional and also the demand-based requirement. We have to control the M2 money. So the GDP is around 250. So it's a kind of overlapping of the overall debt. But the leverage is the local feature. So we have the indirect maybe financing. So a lot of repeated, I mean the calculation overlapping. So we talk about the leverage in China. There might be some misunderstanding. So the structural reform, so not only talking about deleveraging and also the supply and also the system, whether we have the financial reform, we have a moral of our direct financing. So in the Chinese capital market, do you think it's still quite promising? So can you give me a direct answer? So relating to our stock market, whether it's healthy or not. So they have to take some time to recover. How about our bond market? So maybe it's not so difficult for the bond market. So let's return to what you said is a soft budgeting factor for our corporate debt, whether we have this rigid requirement. It's into a non-rigid demand factor. So we have issued our business bond quite long ago. So if there's something wrong with the returns of the interest and the principles, so the holder of the owner of the business bond, they always have a silence protest at the gate of the government organizations. So when the government try to prove the companies' debt. So they are very cautious. So that will affect our direct financing. So they do have this courage to issue, that is local financial facilities. That is another financing tool. So it's not our government debt. So with the government operation, they try to bypass. So that kind of way. So it's a kind of invisible debt of the local government. We have our document 43 for People's Bank. You also issued a lot of bonds and notes. So they try to digest their stock of volume with our central bank. So we want to have a replacement. We have several billion stock of debts. We try to push forward. It's a diversified reform. So this direct financing for the bond market should be pushed to a new high level in our strategies to be clearly included into our agenda of financial reform. So there's still room in the bond market, as you said. So our overall debt, the stock or the inventory of the stock, we issued already more than what the US issued. So the overall planning is global deleveraging. So that is for the overall situation. But for locally, some governments try to increase their leverage. So that is the structure issue and overall volume issue. So thank you so much, Mr. Jia, and also Dr. K. So they are a little bit cautious to give me a direct answer. They want to move to another issues. So I want to add one thing. You talk about the overall volume is deleveraging. So a lot of repeated calculation factors. So anyway, later we'll come back to this issue of how to deleverage. I'll enter into another exciting topic. It's fintech or internet finance. So today in our panelists, we have very two key representative panelists. So the fintech, internet finance, in the past few years, there's a lot of topic and also very good industry and also full of hopes. But later in these years, it's become into a negative term, a lot of P2P. And just over one night, fintech and internet finance has become has played a very negative role. So you have been very experienced, and also for the risk control, you are one of the best companies, and also for the whole industry, you are facing those risks. From your perspective, how do you look at today's risk? So what will be the space for future development? Maybe in the past, we don't have enough regulation. It damages the market. So I think the internet finance or is a financial technology company. So in China, now it's under a kind of transformation. So this transformation so comes from about 5 years ago when we first started in this industry, a lot of new entrants on the companies. Now we have more than 2,000 players. So this is a new industry. So which kind of business model can really create a value? Could solve some market problems or have a sustainable development? This is a kind of process. So no matter which sector, maybe 10 years ago is e-commerce. A lot of companies joined this e-commerce market. But gradually, we have only a few of them. In terms of the scale, their advantages, very few of them are left. Our fintech, in the long run, this industry. So we can see bigger contributions on the local market demand, whether it's investors and financing actors, a lot of opportunities. So when we grew very fast in the past few years, some small company, they don't have this risk control capability. They don't have the data advantages. And also, they don't have those mindset of operation. But from a long-term point of view, the so-called fintech in China. So compared what they have to do for transformation is closely related. So in the following few years in China, the core issues for reducing the risks. So how to mobilize more resources and more capital to turn into those SMEs, and also more resources to those private industries and companies. So a very important figure in China. Look at its state-owned enterprises. Their average ROE as a whole is around 4%. For the private industry, it's around 12% of ROE. So the gap is about 3x. So maybe in the future, more resources and more capital could be directly invested into the non-government organizations, and including the issuance of bonds. Such a kind of transformation to make your real economy stronger and a greater contribution to your real economy. So your future economic outlook, our future fintech development is a kind of transformation. With such a transformation, we can find a sustainable new model. So how do you have a more direct or low cost model to directly support this private economy? That is our core.
Thank you very much. Gregory, you mentioned the transformation and also not only state-owned enterprises, but also the Chinese economy. So for a company, it's not only an internet company, but also a financial company, so that we have to regulate all these companies in a way that's appropriate, which will increase cost. So how can you support your operation nowadays? Well, according to my opinion, in the past few years, a lot of people argue that technology was an independent industry, which I don't think so, because technology is a tool. Whether you are a new company, startup, or a conventional bank, or a traditional company, you can all use this toolkit. You can also seize the business opportunities in the market. So for all these technologies, against the backdrop of the existing regulation framework, we do have something to transform and also to change, because the behavior of your clients, the model of risk prevention and control are different compared to the past few years. So you have to change every minute, which is like the progress of the market. So we have to be dynamic in terms of the transformation. The existing rules are not going to apply in the coming year because of the fast development of the market. We can see the P2P escape and also the internet financing, because there is a gap between the existing situation and also the regulation framework. So I think a key issue is to have a dynamic model to make sure that all these new rules can apply to the market, industries, and sectors, be it new or old. So you're saying that there is a gap between the rules and also the progress of the market. So is it possible that with the same or the similar rules or technologies, you actually curb the progress of the companies? Well, I have to jump in and say something. The internet financing or the fintech, I don't want to go into details for this, but well, actually, we also have the internet insurance. So where is the cutting point? The cross-sector contamination of the risks, we have to prevent and control this. As a platform, cross-banks, cross-sector, cross-trust, all these risks have to be curtailed. This is from the perspective of regulation. And also, there is some illegal fintech, which is the most important potential risk. For the insurance company and also the financial company, you have to pay attention to this. Make sure that you are operating legally. Apart from this, the compliance is also a key word, including the fintech and also the internet insurance. For the CIRS, we have to issue a series of rules and regulations, and also last year we adopted some insurance companies. Three of them had a very good beginning. So after a few months, the capital and also the scale have increased. In 2015, the business increased by 240 billion renminbi. And 2014, the figure was 80 billion renminbi. So you can see that the cloud computing, the big data have provided a very good opportunity of business for the insurance companies. And also at this age of internet plus, we can increase our effectiveness and also efficiency. And we are also diversified in terms of the models like the internet ID, insurance, and also the flight delay insurance. So all these kind of different and diversified insurance models actually make sure that all the needs of the clients can be met. And for all these insurance companies can increase their efficiency, increase their compliance, and also the standardization to meet our requirements from the regulation perspective. In our sector, from the perspective of the regulator, I think actually the risk is controllable. But we are also worried about the cross-contamination, illegal insurance companies, and also the compliance level. Well, thank you, Mr. Zhou.
Of the internet finance, and we also talk about the dark side of the internet finance. So as a observer outside China, what is your sense about China's opportunity and also the risks in the field of the fintech and also in the internet finance, because you are an expert in this industry in Japan?
Okay, as the only non-Chinese speaker on this panel, I hope to give a different perspective. But I think we all try to, when we are faced with problems, I think we all tend to first look at the risks and hone onto the risks. But from my perspective, from a person looking from the outside, as you mentioned, I believe that China is in a relatively advantageous position in terms of promoting innovation in finance. For the following three reasons, I think. One is that although China has been faced with many problems in the banking systems and other financial systems, I think compared to many other countries, they are still don't have legacy financial systems, which will bring up lots of opportunities for new companies to start afresh with new technologies. The second thing is, although the regulators on this panel, they do believe in promoting safety first in the financial system, I believe that they are also more flexible than many other countries. I'm not going to comment on my own country.
Is it a problem or is it a positive side?
I think I'm sure it has both sides, but from looking from the outside, there's a lot of positive sides. And seeing how P2P lending has evolved, seeing how payments has evolved, that kind of technology or that kind of service should, other countries are trying to copy, but has not been able to. And that kind of innovation should or may have come out of, say, the US or somewhere else, but actually it comes out of China because there is that innovative spirit and the regulators are also willing to, trying to accommodate in the reasonable balance that is possible. The third, and this I think is the biggest point, is that China has a thriving ecosystem in terms of innovation. I think it's second to probably Silicon Valley, maybe. And in that sense, I think there are four aspects to it. The first is the people. First of all, there are many people who have a global mindset to begin with. And the second is you have a lot of entrepreneurial talent. You know, if it goes too far, as Mr. Zhao mentioned, there are problems where people go to the extreme and do illegal things. But at the same time, many countries are lacking in this entrepreneurial talent. And this is why, for example, Singapore or other Asian countries, they're trying to import this kind of talent. So China is very at an advantage in the sense that you naturally have this entrepreneurial talent. The second is risk capital. Because people see China as a huge opportunity, and because there's an accommodative stance for fintech, obviously you have your domestic investors, but many foreign investors, many influential investors, for example, the U.S. Very influential Silicon Valley venture capital, such as Sequoia or Lightspeed. These companies are coming in and trying to invest and find good, risk investments. The third is obviously you also have lots of exit strategies, not just only IPOs, but the Tencents and the Alibabas also looking to acquire good companies, which many countries actually lack. And the final is you have a good customer base who is willing to try new products, who is willing to try new, innovative services, which you can't take for granted.
But with no loyalty at the same time.
Yes, there's two sides to every story. But at the same time, for example, in Japan, where 80% of the financial assets are held by people over 60, we lack in that kind of customer base, and so we face a different problem in that the customers are not willing to try these things. And that's why it slows down innovation. So in that sense, I believe that although China is facing some issues around fintech, as Greg mentioned, there's going to be a huge change, a shift in how finance is going to evolve. And it's probably going to evolve over 5-10 years. And I think China is in a good position in terms of leading this change.
Yeah, thank you very much. By adding more a positive weight to our fintech and internet finance. Now we would like to move on to another topic. 那么下面呢, 我们会转入我们另外的一个话题。
So now let's move on to another topic, which is the Brexit. What is the impact on renminbi? We all are discussing this topic, the Brexit, and a lot of people are quite disappointed if you see the renminbi, the middle price, well, actually dropped a lot because the US dollar appreciated a lot. So people are worried about renminbi, whether it will face the pressure like last year in August, and the Fed actually didn't increase the interest rate while the US is appreciated and renminbi one way or another will depreciate. So this is a huge pressure on us. And what about the risks of the capital outflow and also what is the pressure to our system? So in the future, I think this is going to be a challenge for China. So Mr. Zhou, do you have any opinion to share with us? Well, we all listened to Premier Li Keqiang's speech. He emphasized that renminbi is not going to depreciate in the future for a long term. And in terms of the exchange rate management, he said confidence is very important. Confidence is gold. As long as we are confident, we can achieve the financial stability. And if we see the renminbi nowadays, we have to pay attention to the Chinese economy, which is faced with a series of pressures, including the downward pressure. However, with the entrepreneurship and also the new startups cropping up in China, well, actually China's economy is quite promising, in my opinion. And yesterday I came to Tianjin, and the vice mayor said Tianjin's GDP is above 9%, driven by investment. So the demand for money is huge. Against this backdrop, I think the Chinese economy and in Tianjin, driven by investment and also a series of rules and regulations to encourage the private investment and growth, there is no need for us to worry about the depreciation of renminbi in the long run. However, facing with the external uncertainties, well, actually the political and economic factors are intertwined. Well, we don't want to see Brexit. However, this is a fact nowadays.
Now, but you have to really deal with such a hard fact. So we'll have a rain and also natural phenomena is beyond our control. So for our RMB, our exchange rate for long-term stability and also the controlled exchange rate, so we are quite confident about long-term stability of RMB and also from our premier. So there's no such base for further depreciation. We have every reason and evidence for that. So Mr. Jia Kang and Yiping, you want to give some comments. So we'll start with Professor Huang. He's from Central Bank. He's the biggest expert. So I have to raise a more difficult question. Now our RMB exchange rate, we have two components. Yesterday is the closed rate. The other is the quotation. Yesterday a closed rate is a kind of market pressure. So it's not so much depreciation. Another component is the market makers quotation. Based on this mechanism in the market, it's a package of currency. So RMB is more or less stable. How much will be depreciated or appreciation of US dollars? And also RMB will further depreciate. So it's difficult to keep the stability of RMB if we have a further appreciation of US dollars. So do we have to give up such a mechanism? So right now, our central bank is already made it clear our exchange rate mechanism relating to a package of currencies try to maintain stability. So for further interpretation of RMBs, whether it's appreciated or depreciated, we've already have those clear indication of the policy. It's in the total basket of currencies. But we have the habit. Now we look at US dollars as the main indicators. But it's already new policies. We try to highlight the stability with the reference of the basket of currencies. It's relatively stable and also appropriate flexibility relating to US dollars. We already make some trade-off. So this is quite a reasonable arrangement. In the long run, whether it's reasonable or rational or not, that depends. Maybe we are moving to more flexible, but in the short run, so this is quite a good arrangement. So no matter whether it's a Brexit of UK or other global event happened, as long as the any fluctuation of the major currencies around the world, it will have some impact on our RMB. It's a kind of reactive or passive. So I fully believe if you're moving to a fluctuated exchange rate, there will be a more volatility. So we should not be so much concerned about the up and downs, the scale, and also the range. So we were concerned about the impact on our real economy. Secondly, our financial system. So with some fluctuation of exchange rate, try to maintain a certain level of stability. But it is a kind of relation between chicken and egg, or egg and chicken. So otherwise, our financial system will don't have such a hedging phenomenon. It might be more fluctuated. Around the world, many countries' exchange rate is quite flexible. It's a fluctuation. It didn't give too much a bigger problem. So what we should be concerned now is not the short-term U.S. dollars up and down. So we should pay more attention. So we have to know about our future target. So we will move into a flexible exchange rate mechanism. So today, to our target, so how do we take actions? How do we find appropriate opportunities? This should be the concerns of our scholars and the government. And Yiping gave us a good explanation about today and the future. Another one is the capital outflows. If the exchange rate is more resilient and more species, it could absorb some level of capital overflows. But now we're still under bigger pressure. If we have another round of pressure of capital overflows, what policy tools we have? So we do have the policy tools. Our capital account is not fully opened yet. We still have some space. So in a certain period of time, our regulators, they try to monitor those, they strengthen their forces. We still have our foreign currency reserves. So if we have some pressures, if the pressures is more than our expectations, we can use our foreign reserves, try to balance this market. Thirdly, our exchange rate depends on our daily transaction. There is maybe the middle price. So in addition to the previous day's close price, and also the balance relating to a package basket of the currencies. So we can consider some of the policy factors that are involved. And I want to add something. So some of my observations in terms of our RMB depreciation is a kind of way of habit thinking. In the past, we talk about the relation between RMB and the US dollars. Now, RMB is already in the basket of currencies. So we do have such initial natures of reserve currency. Maybe in future, it could be accepted for RMB as the hard currency. So in addition to US dollars, the depreciation also relating to other major currencies. So whether the US dollars depreciate or not, so also the British pounds and also other currencies, they are rising. So RMB depreciation, so to which currency it depreciate or not. For US dollars, maybe it hamper our confidence in the market. Maybe our futures export, if it is promising, so there might be some market adjustment. So on the whole, so it's not necessarily a bad thing for the depreciation of US dollars. It's a kind of fluctuation relating to the market. It's not a crash. So we have to consider this concept of depreciation on the whole. We are stable to the basket of the currency. We do have some time for the floor. So now the floor is open. Please identify yourself first.
I have a question for Mr. Gibbs. 我用中文来讲就是,
I will turn to Chinese. So this is a very competitive market. We have Alibaba and Tencent. They are fighting between those two. So for those two, so who will be the final winner? And of all your Lujiazui, international financial asset management. So what will be the role of your company? So we'll have the next question, and our panelists will give you a total answer of all the questions. I'm from Tangxun. Including the regulators, they all believe the internet finance, to some extent, is a kind of additional financing approach. So our credit market is not so mature, very low default. So some of the companies have to pay about 20 to 40% for borrowing money. So whether they are supporting the economy growth or not, at least the financial cost is very high. So next question.
As recently, the new investment from Japan to China is decreasing rapidly. And what do you think of it? Is it a temporary phenomena because of the situation, because of the China's economic situation, or it will just last a long time? Thank you.
Sorry, can you just repeat your first part?
Recently, the new investment from Japan to China.
You mean is FDI or portfolio investment or FDI investment?
From financial to the
the portfolio?
Yes.
Okay. Portfolio investment rises from Japan to China. What is your comment on that?
Okay.
Okay. 这一位。
我是来自搜狐财经的，我想。
From Sohu Caijing, I want to ask a question relating a very hot topic. My question is to Mr. Zhou. So those Wangke property and also those some very hot topic. So I'm from Jingdao. My question for Mr. Jia. So with such a high risk, not only the government, the regulators, so concerning the sensitive of this investment, especially the first half of this year, many bonds, so they delayed their issuance. So how do you look at the attitude of the investors, the impact on the bond market? So do you have any more questions? I'm from the technology transformation to the services. A question to our panelists. So today we talk about our transformation and development. So how do the financial capital to support the technology innovation? So what kind of support you can offer?
I'm with the DPA, German Press Agency. Just a week ago, the IMF has warned of serious problems if China doesn't deal with the corporate debt, especially of state-owned enterprises. Can you give me a feeling of how serious the situation is, and do you see enough resolve to maybe also shut down big state-owned companies?
Yeah, thank you. 好，我们收了一组问题哈。我想我们
received a series of questions. I think our panelists can find the right questions for themselves. So I have to give the floor to Mr. Zhou. So you asked about those a lot of questions raising concerning some of the public media. They talk about some companies. There's Wangke properties. So they are in the secondary market. So there are some rumors, maybe concerning a certain industry, their long-term investment. So for the China Insurance Regulatory Commission, so we do have some requirement for raising the suspicion about those questions. You have to do a better job for the information disclosure. So what is the source of your investment, and for what purpose you want to invest? So for the insurance company, normally they want to have a better portfolio of investment. So the resources of your capital, you should be disclosed to the public. So the second thing relating to this action, so for your equity investment, we want to add more positive energy, more capital resources, so some requirements. So relating to the certain companies, they do have some actions, their operation, they need further information to be understood by the public, whether they violate their IPO or some regulatory rules or not. So those insurance companies, if anything wrong with their behavior for the secondary market, they should do a better job of the information disclosure to let the society understand your business. So there should be a very fair and also very reasonable evaluation and also the comments from the general public and the society. So a lot of shareholders and also some stock traders or individual traders. So this is quite a big topic from the media. So this is quite normal for the capital market behaviors. So for China, maybe we are not so mature in the capital market. We developed very late. So we don't know how to handle some of the issues. So from our textbooks, from the stories about M&A, so there are so many events that happened around the world. Anyway, if you are involved in the capital market development, the insurance companies, you should do a better job for disclosure of information about your capital, your money. You should be compliant and also actively to be regulated. And also to have a better communication to the society. So thank you for that. So we.
Okay, in terms of investments, I think there were a few questions regarding that. I just wanted to briefly comment. You know, as you know, in Japan, JGBs up to 10 years is negative yield. So Japan is in dire need for somewhere to place their capital. In terms of investment in China, China fintech, there was about 15 billion invested into China fintech in 2015. That's versus 19 billion invested into Silicon Valley or US fintech. So almost the same. And this year in US, it's less than half investment. But the venture capitalists have raised a lot of money. So there's lots of risk capital that is available, but nowhere to park it in both US and in Japan. So I think if China poses like a good opportunity, and as long as it's very clear in terms of its policy and its regulation, I think there's a huge opportunity there.
Yeah, thank you. Jiang Lao Shi.
Oh.
Mr. Jia. Well, just now you raised the question in China, the debt rate is relatively high. What is the take of the investors and what is the impact there is going to be for the investment? And the analysis of the high level of debt, well, generally speaking, the leveraging is a requirement in a macroeconomic sense. But for different players in the market, we have to pay attention to the structural leveraging is supportive to the overall deleveraging. For instance, we have to control the M2 and the fiscal policy. The Ministry of Financing said that the 3% of the deficit and also the national bond is still at a relatively high level. So we have this requirement nowadays. If the investors are getting a better understanding of this, I don't think there is going to be a negative impact on their confidence in terms of the investment. And related to the bond market, and we also have some other factors at the very beginning. Some local governments were worried about the local debt, and the local debt in some province was 1.3 billion RMB. And in terms of the system of the banks, the return ratio is lower. However, the quality of the asset or the capital portfolio is better. So I think for the confidence of the investors, I don't think there is a negative impact on this. I think it's supportive to the healthy development of the economy, and also China has the financial debt. And Mr. Jia, only 30 seconds also for the corporate debt in terms of the SOE reform. We have to crack some of the bottlenecks previously, otherwise the corporate debt cannot have a very good potential to deal with all these issues. And I don't think some people ask me any questions and IMF's worry about the corporate debt. Well, according to IMF, it said that, well, actually the balance sheet of Chinese government is good. So I agree with what you just mentioned. And also, this is some worry from the international investors. Some people say that the speeding up of SOE reform is very important. I agree with that. But actually, there is going to be a gradual process, not overnight. So if you have the anticipation that we will have some good result by the end of this year, I think that's good. Well, Gregory. Well, about the competition, when we think about competition, well, I think it's not only between Tencent and Alibaba. I think there is competition everywhere. And the key issue is that for the new technological tool kit should be combined with the risk control or the risk prevention. So I think this business opportunity is there already. So we have to seize the opportunity. We're already behind the schedule, but still wrap up of this meeting. Just a multiple choice question. In June, China planned to hold the financial management meeting. However, because of the some other arrangements, such as summer Davos, it didn't happen. So about the reform of the financial framework, UK, US, or the current situation model. For the UK model, it's just like the central bank of the UK. And for the US model, well, actually, they're going to be a financial stability council. And for the current situation model, say as the same is that it's a in between of UK and US. I don't know. Well, I would choose the UK model because it's actually dynamic. It's in development to support the financial market. And Mr. Zhou, well, be it whichever model, we have to increase the efficiency of the financial market and also the capability to prevent and cushion the blows and risks, and also to increase the competitiveness of the Chinese companies. So what is your choice exactly? Well, capacity building, increase efficiency. MIO.
United States model or China model, we made some adjustments to the current is
obviously
situation.
The China model.
China model, okay. Remain the status quo. Jia 老师.
我的想法就是要结合着大布置改革。
Well, actually, we also have the reform of the ministries. So for this US model, you just mentioned, well, yeah, actually, that's the UK model, exactly. So thank you very much, panelists. Thank you all for your participation. Let's wish a brighter future for the Chinese financial market. Thank you.